بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وقرآنه الحميد وقوله الحق أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ قال موسى لفتاه لا أبرح حتى أبلغ مجمع البحرين أو أمضي حقبا فلما بلغا مجمع بينهما نسيا حوتهما فاتخذ سبيله في البحر سربا فلما جاوزا قال لفتاه آتنا غداءنا قال لفتاه آتنا قال أرأيت إذ أوينا إلى الصخرة فإني نسيت الحوت قال فإني نسيت الحوت وما أن أذكره قال أرأيت إذ أوينا إلى الصخرة فإني نسيت الحوت وما أنساني إلا الشيطان أن أذكره واتخذ سبيله في البحر عجبا قال ذلك ما كنا نبغ فارتدا على صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
Continuing with our story between Prophet موسى and Al-Khidr صلوات الله وسلامه عليهما, we discuss the first 8 verses of the Surah Al-Kahf. And last night, if you remember, we discussed and we said that the first 8 verses kind of set the stage for what the Surah is talking about. There are 2 groups of people. People who are amanu wa amilu salihat, people who are fooled by zinatul hayat al-dunya. They follow hayat al-dunya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to teach us, to educate us, that don't look at dunya from one perspective only. Yes, there are the natural systems, the natural laws, but there are some other laws which are also natural laws. But those laws follow a different system. They're also laws, but they follow a different system. For example, it is not natural for a person to sleep 309 years. That's not natural. Although, mashallah, some of our youth and some of the people in the holy month of Ramadan, they would like to sleep, mashallah, 309 years, if they can. If they can, they say, Ya Rab, you know, I wish I go to sleep the eve of the holy month of Ramadan, I wake up the eve of Eid. You know, that's something they would like to do. But unfortunately, and you know, out of all the ibadat of the holy month of Ramadan, the one ibadah which we don't fall short on doing is sleeping. You know, an-nawmu fihi ibadah. Sleeping in the holy month of Ramadan is ibadah. And that's the best ibadah we perform in the holy month of Ramadan. Never mind reading Quran, never mind, for example, you know, doing dua, salat, ihya' laylat al-qadr. Nawm, ibadah. You speak to them, halas, ibadah. Let me do my ibadah, please, and do not disturb. It's good you do ibadah of sleeping, no problem, we're not saying anything, but also read the Quran. It's the month of Quran, the month of Salat, month of, you know, A'mal, Laylatul Qadr. Try to read something. So this is also important, dua. Nonetheless, but it's not natural to sleep 309 years. But Allah did it. He made those people of Ashabul Kahf sleep 309 years, and then they woke up. And they were sleeping, they were not dead. They were sleeping, they were alive. Similarly, now in this story between Musa and Al-Khidr, we are going to learn about some things which are not the normal things, the normal system, another system that's in effect. The story began, as we mentioned yesterday, when Musa, salamullahi alayh, the thought crossed his mind that I am the most knowledgeable human alive on the face of the earth today. The thought crossed his mind. Allah sent Jibreel down and said to him, Jibreel, go catch Musa before it's too late, before he destroys himself. This thought of himself thinking he's better, he's the best, that thought should not cross the mind of the Prophet. Go tell him there is a alim, there is someone who's a scholar, who knows more than he does, and he should go and learn from him. How does he know more? We'll talk about who has the more knowledge. That we'll talk about, inshallah. But nonetheless, when Musa alayhi salam learned there is someone who has some ilm, some knowledge that he does not have, yes, Musa received the Torah, received the tashri', the legislative hukum. In other words, if someone comes to Musa and says, how do I pray? Musa teaches him how to pray. Any ahkam of sharia, the laws of legislation, Musa knows 100%. In fact, more than 100%. He is the most knowledgeable on the face of the earth of his time when it comes to sharia, tashri'. Because he's a prophet, he's Hujjatullah. He is one of Ulil Azm. But what the alim has is some other kind of ilm, a knowledge which does not deal with sharia, knowledge that deals with Allah's creation, the knowledge that deals with that other system that I'm talking about, that other system. That knowledge, Musa did not have the whole comprehensive knowledge. That alim had more knowledge in that context. So when it came to legislation, tashri', Musa was the most knowledgeable when it comes to tashri'. Sharia, the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ahkamullah. But when it came to this ahkamut takween, this creation, that system that Allah has put, which is a different system, then the alim, al-khidr, salamullah alayhi, had more knowledge with that system. That's why later on, inshallah, when we discuss the story, all the protests, whenever Musa alayhi salam protested against the alim, was because Musa was looking at things with the lens of tashri', sharia. According to the sharia, you cannot do this. But the abid was doing something differently. He's not doing from the sharia perspective. Allah says, you need to do it, khalas, you do it. وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي. I did not do it of my own. Allah told me. So that will help us understand the essence of the problem when they arise between Musa and Al-Khidr. Musa is looking at things from the sharia perspective, but the alim al-abid is looking at it from a different perspective, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered. Okay, now, Musa is told that you need to go see this alim. Okay, where do I find him? Jibreel, where do I find this alim? He told him you need to go to Majma' al-Bahrain. Okay, where is Majma' al-Bahrain, where the two seas meet? Here, mufassirin have some opinions. Some mufassirin say it is where the Mediterranean Sea meets the Atlantic Ocean, all the way, you know, on the edge of Africa, the other side. But some of the mufassirin say that's too far. No, probably he did not go that far. Okay. So some say, no, there is a different place. Which one? Where the Red Sea meets the Indian Ocean, you know, at the bottom. So when you go south a little bit, you go south, the Indian Ocean and the Red Sea meets, that's where the two seas meet. Some say, no, that's also not where the place, too far. So where? The closest place to Egypt, to Palestine, to that region where he used to live, to Jerusalem, Nazareth, the closest region is the two seas, the Gulf of Aqaba and the Gulf of Suez, where today we have the Suez Canal. That Gulf of Suez and the Gulf of Aqaba, so north of the Red Sea, north of the Red Sea, those two gulfs where they meet, that's where he was supposed to go and meet him. So some of the mufassirin say this. But regardless, now we don't know. The Quran did not mention which Bahrain, but two seas. And there is another opinion as well by some of the mufassirin. They say maybe it was not even by a sea altogether, but rather it's a metaphor. Musa is a sea of knowledge, and so is Khidr. He's also a sea of knowledge. So when the two of them meet, that's where the two seas meet. Some of the mufassirin say, but apparently that may be true. Maybe true, but there was a couple of seas. There was seas where they met at a sea. Okay, so I go there, but how do I find him? What's the sign? So maybe there are so many people there. I go to the sea, and that's where I need to meet him, at the sea. Now, something interesting here.
At the time of Musa alayhi salam, awliya Allah, you know, like Musa is a prophet of Allah, Khidr is a prophet of Allah. They used to meet at the sea, at the beach. That's where they used to meet back in those days. Today, can you meet people at the beach? No. Today, what happened? If you go to the beach these days, you have to run away, especially if it's a nice, you know, sunny day, then you can't. You know, back in those days, awliya Allah used to meet at the beach. These days, you can't meet at the beach anymore, you know. Awliya Allah, if they find them at the beach, these days will be a problem. In fact, some of our fuqaha, they say that going to the beach in such areas where there might be some things which are not appropriate on a nice sunny day is haram, is not allowed. Because then you're going to do haram. You're going to take a look at something which is haram. So some of the fuqaha, they have that issue. Same thing when it comes to swimming pool, co-ed swimming pools. Co-ed swimming pools, some of our fuqaha, they say it is haram to go to a co-ed swimming pool for men and women, of course, both of them. Because the area, that environment is not a healthy environment. Healthy for the ruh, for the spirit, for the sharia, for the deen, for the religion. That's why it's good for the communities to start renting, hiring pools and having one day for the brothers, one day for the sisters. And hiring instructors to teach swimming lessons. So this way, this gap is filled. So when our children say, well, I want to learn swimming, how? We say, here, we hired this pool and we can go and swim at this hired pool. So this is something which is good for the community to look into, especially now that summer is coming up pretty soon, inshallah. Nonetheless, so awliyaullah are meeting at the beach. You know, you go to the beach, that's right. Well, how do I find him? How do I know? This is the right beach, maybe it's a different beach, a different place. He's told, take a fish with you. Take a fish. This fish, wherever this fish, when you lose this fish, that's the place. The place where you lose the fish at, that's the place where you should have met him. You will meet him at the place where you lose. That's your sign. What is the sign? Losing the fish. Okay, so we need to take a fish. Okay, Musa is about to go, set his course, but he does not go by himself. Even in the fiqh, our fiqh, it is mustahab to travel with somebody, with a companion. It's mustahab to travel with a companion. It's mustahab. So Musa wants a companion. Who is his companion? Yusha' bin Nun. Yusha' bin Nun was wasiyyu Musa, the successor of Musa alayhi salam. When Musa died, his wasi was Yusha'. Yusha', some people say he was a wasi, wali min awliya'illah. Some say he was also a prophet. Either way, whether he was a prophet or a wasi. But he was wasiyyu Musa, so he was definitely ma'soom. Ma'soom, because he's a wasi of Musa. He's a successor of Musa. So, when Musa is setting his course, now Musa wants to go quickly. He wants to go quickly. So he tells him, I'm going to continue on my journey until I reach that place where I need to reach. I will not stop. And that's where the ayah begins, or the story begins. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ Musa told his fata, he told Yusha', fata min al-futuwa means a strong man. Yusha' was also strong. لا أبرح. I will not stop حتى أبلغ مجمع البحرين until I reach, you know, the two seas. I will reach that two seas. I will not, even if I have to go and continue for another 80 years. حقبة. Some of the مفسرين said 80 years. Even if I have to walk for another 80 years, I will not stop. I'll continue until I reach it. So he continued. He continued his journey, and with him, now they have a fish. Musa is Kalimullah. He's the prophet. Yusha' is wasi. Who do you think will carry the fish? If you have a prophet of Allah, if you're a companion with a prophet of Allah, and there is a fish to be carried, would you let the prophet carry the fish? Huh? No, you won't. So Yusha' bin Nun, you know, he's carrying the fish with him as well. Allah refers to the fish as al-hut. Al-hut. Hut does not mean that, you know, in Arabic today we use the word hut for whale, nahang. Not nahang, you know, that huge animal, you know, mashallah. Not that one. Otherwise, imagine 30 tons and poor Yusha' bin Nun is carrying this 30 tons of fish with him, you know. That. No, hud in Arabic language means a fish. Maybe it's a slightly larger, maybe 2-3 kilos of a fish. He's carrying this big fish a little bit. Okay, so they go. They arrive to Majma'u al-Bahrain. They get there. They arrive to Majma'u al-Bahrain and they're tired. Apparently, they arrived in the morning. In the morning, they arrived to the place. So they came. They found a big rock.
It's early in the morning, they're very tired, there's a big rock, it's a nice shade, beautiful breeze coming from the sea. You know, what do you people usually do in such cases? Sleep, ahsanto, mashallah. People, that's what people are thinking about right now. Sheikh, khalasna, but let's sleep, you know. Let us do ibadah, ya Sheikh. Let us do ibadah. Even awliya Allah sleep. And you know, nonetheless. So, tired, they wanted to rest a little bit, sleep. Okay, where do I keep the fish? Yusha, he thought that this rock is a pretty good place. You know, I'll keep it on the rock. I'll keep it on the rock. And we'll go sleep. We'll sleep, you know, underneath the rock. So they slept. Now, somehow, this fish got lost. How it got lost, this is a difference of opinion among the Mufassirin. Some of the Mufassirin, they say that it was the change in tides. You know, it was low tide when they slept, but the tide then increased and until it hit the rock and the fish was swept away with the tide. Some say when the water hit the fish was brought back to life, came back to life. Some say maybe the fish was not completely dead. Maybe it's one of those fish which can survive out of the water for a long time, maybe out of the water. Such that the minute the fish hit the water, it quickly swam, it disappeared. Because the minute the water hit the fish disappeared into the sea, jumped quickly. So whether it was brought back to life, whether it remained dead and the sea swept it away quickly, whether, you know, it was alive already, it was not completely dead, all these are opinions. Nonetheless, the fish disappeared into the sea. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَجْمَعَ بَيْنِهِمَا When they arrived to the Majma' al-Bahrain, they arrived. نَسِيَ حُوتَهُمَا فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ سَرَبَا means شَقَّ الْبَحْرِ And he disappeared. They forgot their fish. When they arrived there, they forgot the fish. They forgot the fish, and I'll come back to this issue of forgetting. We'll come back to it. But they forgot the fish. They woke up from their sleep and they continued their journey. Yusha bin Nun saw the fish going back into the sea. He saw that. But he did not tell Musa alayhi salam. He did not inform him that this is where we lost the fish. So Musa gets up, Yusha gets up, and they continue their journey, thinking that we still have to keep going. The sign is there already. They lost the fish. The fish is gone, which means this is the place. But Yusha did not inform Musa alayhi salam. So then what happened? They continued. فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَا They passed the place. قَالَ لِفَتَاهُ Musa told his fata, Yusha, أَتِنَا غَدَاءَنَا Give us our food. غَدَاء In our language today, the Arabic language, غَدَاء refers to what meal? Lunch. But in the Arabic language, غداء من الغدوة يعني breakfast, صباح في الصباح. Early in the morning, they just got up. They slept for a little bit, just rested a little while. They got up. Yusha saw the fish disappearing, but he did not tell Musa. And they continued their journey, thinking that they still have to keep going. So when they became a bit hungry, Musa told his fata, bring us our food. Bring us this food. Where's the fish? We need to eat. Let's have some fish for breakfast. So, آتنا غداءنا لقد لقينا من سفرنا هذا نصبا. You know, we're tired from this travel. This is a long travel. Some of the Mufassirin say that Musa and his fata traveled for 1 year. 1 year, they're walking for a year. Some of the Mufassirin say 1 year. Whether 1 year less than 1 year, nonetheless, they kept on walking. This is a long journey. Now, interestingly, it is Musa who is saying, we are tired, not the fata. The fata didn't open his mouth. You know, the fata was with, you know, Yusha was with Musa walking. He did not complain. Musa now said, لَقَدْ لَقِينَا مِن سَفَرِنَا هَذَا نَصَبَا We're tired. So where is our food? Bring us the fish. Let's have a meal. Let's have some breakfast. Now, what is the answer from? Do they have the fish? Is the fish there? No, the fish is not there anymore. Okay, well, how do you break that news to Musa? How do you tell Musa we don't have the fish? The fish is gone. What do you do? your father comes and says, son, I ordered you to bring us lunch. Did you get us the lunch? Where is the lunch? And the son did not bring the lunch. Now, what do you tell? How do you respond to your father? What do you say to your father? Okay, here, usually what we do, human beings, we try. We sometimes ask questions, you know. Sometimes we ask, lunch? What lunch? What lunch? It says, lunch? You told me to bring lunch? Are you sure, father? This is a question, inquisitive. You throw the question back at the person. This is one thing we do automatically to defend ourselves. Lunch? Really? Yes, I told you to bring lunch. Are you sure you told me? Yes, I sent you a text message. Oh, maybe I did not see the text message, father. I did not see the text message. Ah, okay. So then, khalas, I didn't see them. So you try to shift the blame. That's something we do, shifting the blame. Sometimes we ask inquisitively, lunch? Really? You told me lunch? Really? So that inquisition, that questioning, shifts the blame. And you try to shift the blame. You sent me a text message. You should have called me. You should have called me. Why did you send me a text message? If it were that simple. Now, what did you just do? You shift the blame back onto your father now. You shift the blame to somebody else. That's what we usually do. But in a very polite way, this is what Yusha did. He says, do you know when we went to that sakhra? قَالَ أَرَأَيْتَ إِذْ أَوَيْنَا إِلَى الصَّخْرَةِ Do you know when we went by that rock? Do you remember when we slept by that rock? Yes, I know when we slept. What happened? فَإِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتِ وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ أَذْكُرَهُ I forgot about the whale, about the fish. I forgot about the fish. I forgot about it. And it was Shaytan who made me forget about it. Shaytan made me forget about it. Shifting the blame, shifting the blame. Now, the question is this. وَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ عَجَبًا And this fish that you're talking about, it went into the sea. You know, surprisingly miraculous, عجبا, something strange. That fish, I put it on the rock, and then it jumped into the water, jumped into the sea, and disappeared into the sea. That's something strange, huh? Strange. Have you seen something like this before? Again, shifting the blame. You know, strange. You know, father, did you hear? You know, I didn't bring lunch, but did you hear something? Today, there's no lunch today. People are fasting today. You know, did you hear this? What a strange thing today. You know, all the restaurants are closed today, for example. You know, what a strange thing. No restaurant is open today. You try, surprisingly, ajib, ya akhi. That's how we try to shift the blame sometimes. We had to, you know, where is the fish? Bring me the lunch. Bring me the fish. Bring me the food. Ya akhi, all the shops are closed, subhanallah. I went to 3 shops, they're all closed. And you know something? Why did you send me a text message? You should have told me in person. You shouldn't. Why did you not call me? So we try to shift the blame. Here is what Yusha did. Yusha, being a human being, although he's a ma'soom, but he's trying to be polite. He's trying to be polite to Musa alayhi salam. He says, first of all, do you know when we went by that rock? You know that? Yes. Yeah, I know. What happened? Well, you know, I forgot about the fish. I forgot to tell you that fish. Something strange happened. It jumped into the sea. Ajib, ya, something strange. You know. So why did you not tell me? If that's the case, that's what we want. That's the sign. Missing the, why didn't you tell me? What did he say? فَإِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتِ I forgot. وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ أَذْكُرَهُ Shaytan, it's all Shaytan's fault. It's his fault. He's the one who made me forget. Shaytan. Here is an important theological discussion. Quran says in verse number 61, نَسِيَا حُوتَهُمَا They forgot their fish. Here, Yusha bin Nun, وَصِيُّ النَّبِي He's a wasi. He's a successor of the prophet. He is either a prophet or وَصِيُّ النَّبِي Or both. He's both of them. He's also a ma'soom. He's ma'soom. Musa ma'soom. Infallible. So how could he say, إِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتِ I forgot about the fish. Shaytan made me forget about it. How is that possible? Do prophets forget? Is that something possible? This is an important discussion. Here, Al-Shaykh al-Saduq. Shaykh al-Saduq is one of our big ulama. He died in the year 381 Hijri. Shaykh al-Saduq. And he's buried in Shah Abdul Azim. If you go to Shah Abdul Azim today in Iran, in Tehran,
If you go to Shah Abdul Azim, Al-Hasani, there is the qabr of Al-Shaykh Al-Saduq, radwanullah ta'ala alayh. Great alim, big alim, big. But Al-Shaykh Al-Saduq, he says that it is possible that the Prophet, our Prophet, forget. And he narrates some ahadith in that context. When it comes to Risaleh, he doesn't forget. Quran, message, whatever. But other things, maybe he forgets. He is the only Shia Sheikh to say this. No other Shia. Even his student, the Sheikh Al-Mufid, he doesn't agree with him. He says, no, that's not the case. Prophets don't forget. So that's why in the Shia school of thought, if you only take Saduq out of the equation, which is who's only one scholar, one alim, that's why Sheikh Al-Mufid says, if we are to doubt between whether the Prophet forgets or a Sheikh al-Saduq forgetting, maybe Sheikh Saduq himself forgot about the other ahadith and the ayat of the Quran that suggest that the Prophet does not forget, we would think that Saduq forgets, not the Prophet forgets. Maybe Saduq himself forgot about some of the ayat, some of the ahadith. And therefore, even early scholars, people who are contemporary to Sheikh al-Saduq, did not agree with him. Prophets do not forget. They do not, you know, they're infallible. So they don't make mistakes. So then how do we come to these ayat? What do we say here? Here we have some ideas from the fuqaha, ulama. One opinion from Sheikh Nasir Makarim Shirazi. Sheikh Nasir Makarim Shirazi, who's a marja' today in Iran, has a tafsir called Tafsir Namuna, or in Arabic he calls it Al-Amthal. In his Tafsir Al-Amthal, or Tafsir Namuna, Sheikh Nasir, when it comes to this ayah, when it comes to this ayah in Surah Al-Kahf, he says, prophets do not forget when it comes to risala, when it comes to risala, tabligh, and so on and so forth, they don't forget. But if it were from a test, in the form of a test, like this case, this was a test for Musa, a test for Yusha, maybe they can't forget. Maybe it's possible that they can forget. That's one opinion. Sheikh Nasir says, when it's in the form of a test, maybe they forget. Prophets forget. That's possible. That's one opinion. Another opinion, Allama al-Tabatabai, in his Tafsir al-Mizan, he says, no, it's not a matter of forgetting. It's a matter whether Shaitan can harm the prophets. Can he cause harm to the prophets or not? He cannot affect their aql. Shaitan cannot affect the aql, cannot make the prophet forget, cannot whisper to the prophet. He cannot do any of these things. However, can Shaitan harm the prophet, cause him some harm? He says, maybe. That's possible. That's possible. Why? Because he says, when it comes to Surah Sad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse 41, talking about Ayyub, Prophet Ayyub alayhi salam, he says, وَذْكُرْ عَبْدَنَا أَيُّوبِ إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بِنُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ. Ayyub called Allah, said, Ya Allah, Shaytan has hurt me, bothered me, troubled me. So therefore, when it comes to bothering the prophets, hurting them, he can. But he cannot do it, of course, without the permission of Allah. If Allah doesn't want him to do so, then he cannot do it. Therefore, Allah gives permission, allows. And it could be in the form of a test. Again, a form of a test to these prophets, to demonstrate their greatness. So that's the second opinion. So the first opinion by Sheikh Nasir, who says that prophets don't forget, but when it comes in the form of a test, maybe they can't forget. Sheikh, you know, Allama al-Tabatabai says, no, it's not about forgetting, but rather Shaitan harms them, affects them. And that's only with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the second opinion. A third opinion suggests, no, the prophets cannot forget. Cannot forget. Why? Sayyid Munir al-Khabbaz, Ayatullah Sayyid Munir al-Khabbaz, may Allah bless him, inshallah. He's one of our ulama today alive. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, in ayah number 64 of Surah An-Nisa, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. We did not send any messenger but to be obeyed. The messenger has to be obeyed by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The messengers have to be obeyed. طَاعَ. Allah says, our Prophet, what does he say? Ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul. Not only with matters of legislation, when he tells you to pray, salat, Quran, but rather anything. Whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi tells you to do, you have to do it. There is no question. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi in the laws, in the books of fiqh, in the ahkam, tells us that we have to wear hijab, we have to wear hijab. There is no question about it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi tells us, for example, you have to do this, you have to do it. No question, no questions asked. Khalas. Whatever the Prophet says, you have to do it. All the prophets, in fact, all the prophets, Allah says, we send them so that they are obeyed. Obeyed not only with legislation, but rather with all the laws. Whatever a prophet tells you to do, you have to do it. This means, how can he forget? If Allah says, I want you to obey him, how can he forget? So on one end, Allah tells you that you have to obey the prophets. On another end, if he forgets, no, don't worry. If he forgets, then you should not listen to him when he forgets. Well, that's contradictory. That's self-contradictory. So it cannot be. That's why the prophets do not forget. So then, how do we explain this ayah? Yusha bin Noon here, according to another alim, Ayatullah Sheikh Abdul Karim Al-Ha'ari, who is currently alive in Karbala, he says, it's shifting the blame. وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانِ Shaitan, you know, made me forget. He's just shifting the blame. Shaitan cannot make him forget. Shaitan will not be able to make him forget. They don't forget. But it's a matter of shifting the blame. Just like we said, when your father tells you, why didn't you bring lunch? Well, why didn't you call me dad? Why did you send me? You're shifting the blame here. It's a game of shifting the blame. Shifting the blame. So it's just shifting the blame. That, you know what, I did not tell you. Maybe Yusha bin Nun did not realize that this is such an important event and he had to tell him. But he is now shifting the blame. You know, Shaitan made me forget to tell you. So it's just a matter of shifting the blame. But otherwise, they don't forget. They don't forget. He remembered. He knew this was happening. But he did not inform the Prophet. So then what about, you know, nasiyahutahuma? They forgot their fish. They did not forget the fish. It's not about forgetting the fish, but rather forgot. Here, it means they left it. They left the fish. So these words, when it comes to nisyan, forgetfulness, they need to be reinterpreted. They need to be interpreted such that they match what the Quran says. Quran says about the prophets, they are infallible, that they are sent so that they are obeyed. They have to be obeyed in every matter. Shaitan cannot have access to the prophets, make them forget, change. So every time they forget, or the ayah forget, it means, you know, they either, in this case, they left the hoot. They left it. They did not forget about it. They left it. It was left over there. Yusha bin Nun did not tell Musa. He saw, but he did not tell. So he's telling him, you know, Shaitan, game, you know, blame shifting. Shifting the blame. Musa alayhi salam later on in the same surah tells Al-Khidr, you know, I forgot. You know, I gave you the promise, but I forgot. Here, forgetting is not forgetting, but rather, I gave you a promise, but I did not follow along with this promise. Why? Because you did something against the Sharia. You know, you did something against the Sharia. You know, you broke something, you harmed something. That's against the Sharia. I have to speak. This is Amr bin Ma'ruf Nahi al Munkar. I can't just keep quiet. Okay? So from that perspective, the prophets, sometimes the ayat say, you forgot, and so on and so forth. Otherwise, they never forget. And this leaves us with the last ayah, which also happens to come in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to our Prophet, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ Remember your Lord if you forget. How could Rasulullah forget? وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ He, you know, أَطِيعُ اللَّهُ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولُ So how could he forget? He does not speak of desire. It's all a revelation. In some of these ayat, Mufassirin say, Quran is talking to the Prophet, but he wants us to listen. You people listen. You forget. Rasulullah doesn't forget. It's like when you have two children. If you have, for example, two children, one of them, mashallah, is an angel. You know, he sits next to you like this, mashallah, sits next to you, And he listens to the muhadara, right, Amin? MashaAllah, you're listening? MashaAllah, look at him, MashaAllah. Just like an angel sitting there. Very good. Like, you know, the sister Maryam here is sitting like an angel, MashaAllah. And all these angels that are here, MashaAllah, listening. Very good. And you have another one who, MashaAllah, SubhanAllah, يعني, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. يعني, yeah, he turns the whole place upside down. You know. So what do? You're about to leave the house. You're about to leave the house. You come to your son who is the angel. But the other one is listening. You say, listen, listen. I'm going to leave the house. If I come back and something has broken in this house, guess what? You will be grounded for 3 days. 3 days you're grounded. No more video games. Nothing. The other guy will say, Ya Allah. If this is what he's saying to this angel, he will be grounded 3 days. What was going to happen to me? You know, what's going to happen to me? You are not talking to this guy. You want the other guy to listen. You want the other guy to listen. This is also a method in the Holy Quran where Allah speaks to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, but he's not talking to him. He's talking to us. Remember your Lord if you forget you, human being. If you forget Allah, remember Allah. Do istighfar. Obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow the command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. This is what you have to do. أَطِيعُ اللَّهُ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولُ وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا in Surah Al-Ahzab. أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. If Rasulullah and Allah, Allah and His Messenger, if they dictate something to you, if they tell you to do something, you have no choice anymore but to do it. You can't argue. You can't say why. There's no why. خلاص, you believed in him. You believed in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Do you believe in Nubuwwah? Remember Usul al-Din? Do you believe in Tawheed? You believe in Nubuwwah? You believe in Adala? You believe in Imama? You believe in the Qiyamah? You believe in the Quran? You believe in the words of Allah? خلاص, then no questioning anymore. Rasulullah says, you do this, you do this. End of story. And this is something important. So the prophets do not forget. And they never make mistakes. They are completely infallible. And same thing applies to the imams, alayhim as-salam. The imams, same thing. They don't forget. They don't commit mistakes. And all those ayat in the Quran that may suggest otherwise, they have to be interpreted. They have to be explained. And some of them, our imams, alayhim as-salam, have explained. If you refer to Kitab al-Ihtijaj by Sheikh al-Tabrasi, Allama al-Tabrasi, there is a discussion between Imam al-Ridha and al-Ma'mun al-Abbasi about some of these verses where, you know, a prophet might say, I forgot. A prophet say, maybe I made a mistake, and so on and so forth. I oppressed myself. Zalamtu nafsi. What does it all mean? Imam responds to all those claims. So you can refer to Kitab al-Ihtijaj by al-Allama al-Tabrasi. One of the people who obeyed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and followed him was Abu Talib, radwanullahi ta'ala alayhi. Abu Talib, the father of Imam Ali salamullahi alayhi. There is a narration that on the seventh day of the holy month of Ramadan, like today, coincides with the wafat of Abu Talib. There is another tradition that his wafat was on the 26th day of Rajab. 26th of Rajab. Another one on the seventh day, like today. Abu Talib, radwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, salamullahi alayhi, he took care of his nephew, took care of him. He was about 35 years older than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. 30 to 35 years older than Rasulullah. How old was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi when he was sent? Do you know? How old was Rasulullah, the Prophet, when he was sent? Do you know? How old was he? Yeah? Anybody? I mean, you know? No? Maryam, do you know? How old was Rasulullah when he was sent? No? 40. MashaAllah. Say salawat for Amin. MashaAllah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alayhi. We thank Allah for the Wi-Fi signals. Wi-Fi signals, mashallah, there. What beautiful. So 40 years old. So this means how old was Abu Talib? If he was 30 to 35 years older than Rasulullah, how old would he be? 70 to 75 years of age. Not young. Yet, he took care of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, protected him, looked after him, did not allow Quraysh to bother him. One day the Prophet was praying in the Haram, in Masjid al-Haram. Quraysh brought some, you know, old bones of a camel with some blood, and they threw it on his back. So the Prophet, you know, he got hurt by this. He came to his uncle, Abu Talib. He said, Ya'am, am I not from Bani Hashim? He said, yes, you are. Am I not of you? Yes, you are of me. You're my nephew. He says, then why do these people do this to me? Why do they do this to me? He said, who did this to you? He said, people were sitting in Mecca in the Masjid al-Haram. They did this to me. He comes. He says, Abu Talib, come with me. He goes to Hamza. Hamza, come over. Hamza was also mu'min, Muslim. Hamza was Sayyad al-Usud, the hunter of the lions. Very brave. Abu Talib and Hamza come with the Prophet. They come. Quraysh were all sitting down in the Masjid al-Haram. The minute they saw Hamza with Abu Talib, they were about to run away. Abu Talib looked at them and said, everybody sit down. Quiet. So everybody sat down. Like wood. Khalas. Abu Talib said, quiet. He told Hamza, go bring the bones that they threw on the Prophet. Go bring them. They brought the bones. And he took the bone and the blood and touched each one of their mustaches. You know, a sign of humiliation. He said to them, listen, next time if you do something like this to my nephew, you have only yourselves to blame. You don't touch him. And indeed, they dared not to touch him anymore. So they could not touch Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. As long as Abu Talib was alive. But on a day like today, maybe, or the 26th day of Rajab, Abu Talib leaves this dunya. Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi alayhi, runs to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and he says, Ya Rasulullah, my father has died. My father has died. So Rasulullah cries. He cries. One of the Sunni ulama, al-Shablanji, al-Shafi'i, in his book, Nur al-Absar, he's Sunni, not Shia. He narrates the story. He says, Ali came to Rasulullah and said, Ya Rasulullah, my father has died. So Rasulullah cried and he said, Ya Ali, go and do his ghusl and kafan. And he attended his procession. Rasulullah attended the procession of Abu Talib. And they buried him. And he did the Salatul Mayyit. Imam Ali did Salatul Mayyit because the son is more preferably to do Salatul Mayyit on his father. It's more preferably. So Imam Ali did the ghusl, kafan, Salatul Mayyit. Do you do these things on a kafir? Do you do Salatul Mayyit on a kafir? Do you do ghusl of a kafir? No, you don't. This means he was a mu'min. He was a Muslim. He was a believer, a strong believer. And that's what all the imams say. All the imams were asked, was Abu Talib Muslim, mu'min? Some of the imams, their reply was, if you doubt the iman of Abu Talib, then there is a problem in your iman. If you believe that he was not a mu'min, you have a problem in your iman. So he was a mu'min. Even his poetry spoke about praising Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. But then he was buried, salamullahi alayhi, in Mecca. I say, Ya Rasulullah, you attended to the funeral of your uncle Abu Talib. You were there. Imam Ali did his ghusl, his kafan, his salat al-mayyit. He buried him. Who was there on the day of Ashura for Imam al-Husayn salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi? When he was all alone in Karbala, Zainab alayha salam came to the body of Imam al-Husayn and she cried, Ya Jaddah, Ya Rasulallah, Hada Husaynuka fil ara maslub al-imamati wal-rida. This is your Husayn in Karbala, all alone, Ya Rasulallah. Then she looked after, you know, she looked after some of the children of Imam al-Husayn. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was there with Imam Ali alayhi salam. He was there with the children of Abu Talib. He was helping them, giving them, you know, some comfort. He was there with the wife, with Fatima bint Asad. But who was there for the children of Imam al-Husayn on the day of Ashura? Zainab alayha salam missed one of the daughters of Imam al-Husayn, Sukayna. Where is Sukayna? She found her hugging the body of her father. She was only about 5-6 years old. She is hugging the body of her father, a body full of arrows and spears. And she was crying, Abata, ya man alladhi hazza waridak, Aba man alladhi qaddaba shaybatak. Oh father, who beheaded you? Why is your head separated from your body? Ah, go off, Baba. بعد تو من خار شدم به اسیری به سر کوچه و بازار شدم يا أثار الأبو يا ناس خيمة يفي على بناته وحريمة يا والدي والله ظيمة أنا أصير من زغري يتيم بويا والنوح من عقبك لجيمة نذرا علي لئن عادوا وإن رجعوا
لأزرعن طريق الطف ريحانة إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. Raise your hands in the دعاء. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. 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 اللهم اكشف عنا السوء يا الله. اللهم وفقنا لما يرضيك، جنبنا معاصيك، اجعل عواقب أمورنا إلى خير. إلهي اقض حوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات، شاف وعاف جميع مرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات. اللهم اغفر لي ولوالدي وارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا. رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي، ربنا وتقبل دعاء. اللهم بحق أبي طالب اجعلنا عتقائك من النار يا الله، واحشرنا في زمرة محمد وآله الأطهار يا الله، وارزقنا شفاعتهم في الدنيا وفي القبر وفي الآخرة لقضاء الحوائج ولشفاء المرضى ولكشف هذه الغمة عن هذه الأمة ولتعجيل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان. وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات، لا سيما أرواح أموات الجالسين والحاضرين والباذلين والمساهمين والمؤسسين، وإلى روح والدتي المرحومة رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.